Aureus, 10 de Filococcus aureus y 6 gran positive focus. Produces many diseases, the virulence factors or the pathogenesis of many infections is first, it has coagulase. This coagulase adheres to the fibrin and produce a coating of the bacteria with fibrinogen, so we cannot now attack the bacteria because it is coated with fibrin or fibrinogen. Next, we have the leucocidin, also called phantom Valentine leucocidin, that forms pores in the membrane of the white blood cells and so destroy them, and so they cannot attack the bacteria. This is because of the necrotizing pneumonia that can present with hemoptysis and shock. Also of some cellulitis like abscesses and nodules that fluctuate and are very, very big, painful. This is the mechanism of action, the leucocidin toxin. Alright, next we have the hyaluronidase. This spreads the disease because it's blocking the hyaluronic acid. Next, we have the fibrinolysin, also called the staphylococcus kinase. This inhibits or destroys the fibrin. Next, we have the lipase that allows the spread of the staphylococcus aureus in the adipose tissue, like in sebaceous glands. Also, we have the penicillin. The penicillinase breaks down the beta-lactam antibiotics, so usually we should treat it with vancomycin. And if we cannot treat it with vancomycin, we have, because of resistance, could be vancomycin resistance or vancomycin intermediate, we treat it with dalfaprostin or quinaprostin. But first, there are other diseases that are caused by Staphylococcus aureus that not are that we should not initiate first vancomycin. This is, for example, in topical diseases, we begin with mupirocin. For some other diseases, we can give oxacillin, napsacillin, decloxacin, unless the cultive result positive for resistance to this penicillin, narrow spectrum penicillin, then we should give vancomycin, because this means that this staphylococcus aureus was MRSA, methicillin resistant staphylococcus aureus, and so we should treat with vancomycin. And if this strain is also resistant to vancomycin, then dalfaprostin or quinaprostin. Alright, but now let's go back to the diseases. We have the toxicogenic enzyme. This is the toxic shock syndrome toxin. This produces shock, and is a super antigen. Acts like a super antigen. This is the MHC class 2 expressed by macrophages, dendritic cells, and lymphocytes, joins with the receptor in the lymphocyte, but without expressing any antigen. So here, this toxic shock syndrome toxin binds to these two and produce the activation, massive activation of many lymphocytes, and so we have the toxic shock syndrome of that present with hypotension, hepatotoxicity, increases in the aminotransferase enzymes, bilirubin, also desquamation, very important desquamation of the palms and soles, could be of other parts of the skin, but this is very characteristic, that desquamation and the multi-organ damage that could lead to failure. Alright, also the scalp skin syndrome. This is produced by a toxin, a E toxin, that binds to the desmoglein enzyme in the desmoglein protein of the desmosome in the stratum granulosum and produce the elevation of this and this formation of the stratum granulosum. And so this skin is falling off, usually in children, very commonly around the umbilicus. Next, we can have impetigo. Impetigo could be simple impetigo or non-bullous impetigo and bullous impetigo. Bullous impetigo is only caused by Staphylococcus aureus. Non-bullous impetigo could be caused by Staphylococcus aureus or Streptococcus pyogenes. In one, we have Nikolsky sign positive. This is when we rub the vesicle. The vesicle would be for bullous impetigo is Nikolsky positive and it would fall off. If we rub in a non-bullous impetigo, it would not fall off. Alright, and impetigo looks like crusty yellow lesions. Alright, next the septic arthritis and osteomyelitis. In osteomyelitis is the infection of the bone. Staphylococcus is the most common cause, unless the patient has sickle cell disease, in which case would be salmonella. Also in septic arthritis, it presents with swelling and redness of the involved joint, and this usually is seen in any kind of age, unless the patient is in reproductive age, in which would be Neisseria gonorrhea. Next we have pneumonia. Pneumonia usually could be a bronchogenic pneumonia or a lower pneumonia, in which we would have cavitations. Very important, the cavitations in the lung and empyema, usually also with empyema. Next, we can have endocarditis. It would be acute endocarditis, usually in AV drug patients patients with a catheter central line, in which case the infection is coming first from the skin and in the tricuspid valve, and then it can go or to the brain or to the pulmonary artery. And usually it would only stay in the pulmonary artery, and so for that, the endocarditis that is caused by Staphylococcus, that is in the IV drug users, it has a better prognosis than the endocarditis caused by rheumatic fever or something, subacute endocarditis that produces the vegetation in the left side of the heart, because that would go to the brain. The other would just stay in the pulmonary artery. Alright. Next, we have abscesses and mastitis. Presents again with redness, swallowing of the tissue. We have the skin infection. We already talked about the Staphylococcus scald skin syndrome and the impetigo. We also have cellulitis and folliculitis. This is just the infection of the base of the hair follicle. A lot of folliculitis, that is many follicles infected, produce a furuncle. And a lot of this, the agglomeration of this, would be carbuncles that we should drain them. And the cellulitis also is caused by the leucocytine, phantom valentine leucocytine enzyme. So we would have abscesses. Alright. Next, usually all of these are caused of coagulases and cytolysin enzymes of the Staphylococcus aureus. Just the foodborne disease, that is the gastroenteritis, that is caused by exotoxin, that is the exotoxin preformed in the food. So this is not when yes the bacteria, it's when yes the toxin and produces a watery diarrhea, self-limited, but is the most rapidly exotoxin acting, because it acts in like less than 4 hours could be. Alright. Next, exfoliating toxin is the cause of the Staphylococcus scald syndrome, of the impetigos, of the skin tissue usually. We already talked about the treatment. The treatment for toxic shock syndrome toxin that we talked about, this the treatment is vancomycin to eradicate the bacteria and some, maybe some macrolide or some cephalosporin, ceftriaxone or maybe clindamycin in order to inhibit the synthesis of the toxin. So we are giving some inhibitor, protein synthesis inhibitor, in order to inhibit the synthesis of the protein, this toxin. And this syndrome is usually seen in patients or with a tampon in the vagina that they use a lot and they do not change for a long period of time, or a nasal package could be a tampon or a Kleenex for a lot of time, could be like days, that they could produce a toxic shock syndrome toxin.